Andrew Gavin Marshall with the Center for Research on Globalization joins me now from Montreal, Canada. Hey there, Andrew.
Hi, thanks for having me.
The IMF, the World Bank, these created back in 1944, you know, kind of to finance reconstruction in Europe and to develop the third world. But let's break down the evolution of what they've come to mean over the last half century. What's changed in terms of what they were supposed to be and what they've become?
Well, an important thing to keep in mind is that while they emerged out of the 1944 Bretton Woods Conference, the plans to create them were actually implemented earlier. Specifically in 1941 and 1942, the Council on Foreign Relations, which is an elite U.S. think tank, developed war plans during the war with the State Department to redesign the global political economy, create a new world order in which America would be supreme. To do this, they came up with the idea for two major institutions, which became the IMF and the World Bank. These would essentially manage the third world, Latin America, Africa, Asia, for the benefit of U.S. and Western European corporations and banks.
But that's not the way it was sold. I mean, in some ways, it was sort of portrayed as, you know, these institutions looking out for the poor countries, coming in to help them. And you just said it's actually benefiting the wealthier countries.
Yeah, well, just as you have to judge a person by what they do as opposed to just what they say, so too do you have to judge an institution on the same basis. Now, while the IMF and the World Bank say that they're interested in reducing poverty and development, all their actions have said otherwise, and the repercussions of their actions have exacerbated poverty created underdevelopment. You look at Africa and Latin America during the 60s, coming out of the colonial era, independence movements, these countries were developing quite rapidly in Africa. The growth rates were extreme until the oil crises, which were in fact, the oil price increases were supported by the U.S. State Department. And this created a flood of money through the Western banking corporations being loaned to these developing countries to finance industrialization. In 1979, when the U.S. Federal Reserve raised the interest rates so that they were 2% in the late 70s and 18% in the early 80s, all this money, all these loans, the interest rates dramatically increased, and this set off the 1980s debt crisis, which spread throughout Latin America, starting with Mexico and across Africa and Asia. This led to the World Bank and IMF coming to the scene to rescue these developing nations by making them restructure their economies.
And it seems, Andrew, they're not just restructuring their economies to try to pay back this debt. A lot of times, they're restructuring the entire landscape of their country. I mean, you take these gorgeous rainforests in some of these third world countries, places where certainly a lot of things could come out of, and they're having to, you know, tear these down to build crops, to make money, to pay back their debt. What do you make of all this? And what do you make of the fact that, you know, the IMF and the World Bank have this meeting and they're talking about these policies and how to fix things when a lot of critics at least say they're the ones who caused this?
Absolutely. And they had a significant role in creating this crisis. They essentially act as neo-colonial institutions. Like you pointed out, they have to deconstruct rainforests and agriculture and focus on what's called export induced growth. So producing, say, a cash crop. Like in Rwanda, they were forced to produce coffee for export because this was portrayed as something that would dramatically increase production, give the country benefits, economic benefits, growth, etc. But if you look at the formal colonial era in Africa of European empires controlling the regions, it was done in the same way. They make countries produce certain crops for export to the European nations, and then thus making the countries dependent upon the European nations for food and other services. So it creates a dependency. So the IMF and World Bank have essentially created this global dependency of the South, Africa, Asia, Latin America, on Western Europe and North America, which heavily subsidize their agricultural products for export. And in terms of today, they're trying to do how these institutions have changed today specifically is that not only are they interested in continuing to manage the so-called developing world, but they're also trying to integrate and advance the process of global governance by bringing in emerging nations such as China and India and other nations into this institutional apparatus of global governance by bringing them to the game, essentially.
Andrew, let's talk about accountability here. I mean, again, these organizations, IMF, World Bank, meeting about policies, thinking ahead, trying to figure out what to change. The fact is, from what I understand at least, if you work for the World Bank, you're basically immune from any kind of legal action. Who are these organizations accountable to in terms of making sure that they actually are doing what they say they're going to do?
They're accountable to the interests that own them. And it's very simple to actually see who runs these institutions. If you take the World Bank historically, many of its presidents have always come from or been somehow related to Chase Manhattan Bank, which is now JP Morgan Chase. If you look at the second president of the World Bank, John J. McCloy, he was chairman of Chase Manhattan Bank. He was chairman of the Council on Foreign Relations. He was chairman of the Ford Foundation, a trustee of the Rockefeller Foundation. So the interests that run these institutions are very well represented in their actions. But from the rhetoric of serving the poor, you just have to sort of put that aside. That's not a reality.
All right. Andrew Gavin Marshall from the Center for Research on Globalization joining us from Montreal, Canada.